The Advent that we experience is very much about light and darkness. In dark times, in times when it seems that the darkness will only get deeper, the darkness seems impenetrable, and we wonder if light will ever return. Our tradition teaches us that when things look bleak, we are to be confident that God is with us. That is the meaning of Emmanuel. El is the Canaanite word for God, predating Yahweh. We use the Dutch word God, which comes from the German word Gott. God has many names. So when we call Jesus Emmanuel, we are saying that he is a sign that God is with us, that God has not abandoned us in the darkness, that beyond this time of fear and growing anxiety, we believe that God remains in our midst, that God will be faithful to us, and that should be a compelling reason for us to be faithful to God. We look to the Bible to teach us about this appreciation we have for the presence of God. Today we connect with a reading from the Hebrew Bible in the book of Isaiah, where God is speaking to his people about when a hero shows up to lead the people. Raymond Brown, in speaking of the general readers of the Bible, asserts that our religion is based on a belief that God has communicated with human beings and that the Bible is a privileged vehicle of that communication. And the understanding that we glean from a disciplined reading of the text, reading it every week, will inform our faith with nuggets of truth, of wisdom, and of inspiration. This text from Isaiah has some complicated elements. For example, they rejoice before you as with the joy at harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. We can understand the joy at harvest, but most of us have no experience exulting when dividing plunder. Arr, matey. Shepherd of the Hills will be dividing plunder on the second Sunday in January. So we see that not everything in the Bible applies to our situation, but was intended for the audience there in front of the author. We have to pick out the good stuff that works for us. So here's what we can harvest from this section. Verse 2, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. Verse 4, for the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you, God, have broken. Verse 5, the ending of war. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. Then comes the promise that God will bring leadership to the people when it is most needed. Verse 6, for a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The ending is an aspirational statement of the hopes of this star-crossed and often conquered people. Verse 7, his authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Now we know that the kingdom of David was not established and upheld with justice and righteousness forevermore. This did not happen. David's son Solomon was wise and a great builder of the temple, but he had a troubled reign. His son Rehoboam was such a lousy king that it broke the kingdom in half, Israel to the north and Judea to the south. The kingdom of David lasted barely one generation beyond him. So this text is not prophetic in the sense of predicting specifically the future. It doesn't, and it can't. It speaks to the aspiration of the people and their faith that God is with us. And this is a central principle of these texts, that they do not point forward to something that actually happened. They are not magic. They are aspirational and inspirational. They tell us of the confidence that God will be with us. And when we have the occasion to recognize that something amazing has happened, that this monumental person named Jesus has come with new insight and powerful new visions, one who teaches with authority, then we take his life and point backwards and say, see, this is the kind of thing that Isaiah was talking about. Isaiah spoke of things like this happening. This is part of God's promise to us. So the New Testament points back at the Old Testament and says, we recognize God's hand in what we see here. It's not that the Old Testament points to the New Testament and says, this book is magic. It can predict the future, which is what I was taught growing up. The Bible is not magic. It is, however, amazing and inspirational and contains unsearchable riches that teach us the history of humanity's relationship with the one God. Our reading from the New Testament is the Hymn of Mary, oftentimes referred to as the Magnificat, because she magnifies. This is an important work, not just because Mary is the mother of Jesus. It is an important piece of insight, a moment of clarity and understanding of the role that each of us has in the building of the kingdom of God, in building the beloved community, right here where we are. It is modeled on the song of Hannah, who praised God for the miracle birth of Samuel. Miracle births in the narrative are how the storyteller asserts that we see God's hand in this person and we should listen to this person. Let's go with this vision of magnifying the Lord. We can imagine a magnifying glass and a couple things it can do. If you use it to look at words on a page, it makes the words bigger. It makes it easier to see and to understand. If we look at what the magnifying glass does to light, it gathers it and focuses it. It can turn it into an intense heat, enough to light some leaves or some kindling when building a fire. In Luke 12:49, Jesus said, I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it was already kindled. Mary then takes the light and magnifies it. We recall the people on the road to Emmaus. Were not our hearts burning within us when Jesus was opening the scriptures to us? Mary's surrender to the will of God intensifies our experience of the light of God, this light to enlighten the Gentiles. The Greek Orthodox tradition holds Mary in very high esteem and describes her as Theotokos, the bearer of God into the world. And they cast us as believers, as people charged with bearing God into this world in every way we can. Male or female, or everything in between, adult or child, we are all to bear God into the world, as Mary has done. We are all to magnify the presence of God through the work of our soul, as Mary has done. Sometimes Presbyterians can be rightly accused of being rather bookish, stuck in our heads, parsing the meaning of words and splitting hairs in an attempt to refine our understanding. That's not bad if it is done in moderation, but it can fade into being argumentative and legalistic. Our tradition, Presbyterianism, comes from Scotland, which considers the use of any word to be expensive. You only say what you have to. And as I heard last week, if you have one Scotsman, you have a kirk, a church. If you have two Scotsmen, you have a schism. You have two denominations. And we have to own up to this, as there are 8 Presbyterian denominations in the U.S. And one of the things we argue about is the nature of the lived experience in the presence of a God that we believe is embedded in our lives. The Bible is a text trying to describe something, the spiritual experience, that cannot be put into words. We try to describe the indescribable. The Jewish tradition talks about this directly. The Torah, it is said, is written in black ink on the page, but the page is mostly white, representing everything that surrounds the words that cannot be put into words. About 30 years ago, there was a long Presbyterian discussion about spirituality and how we seem to push the Holy Spirit off to the side because we cannot intellectually nail it down. The idea of spirituality in the faith had been poo-pooed for a long time, so much so that it created some confrontational moments with those old-timers who thought this spirituality thing was some woo-woo thing creeping in from the Unitarians and the hippies, like some sort of self-help thing. There was a discussion where one agitated gentleman stood up and said with vitriol in his voice, "I've been a Presbyterian for more than 40 years, and I can assure you there is nothing spiritual about it." I would tend to dispute that. For me, a great deal of time and interest should be invested in the spiritual appreciation and development of our soul. We do that through prayer and through silence. This developing of the spiritual self includes our hearts, our minds, our essential being. Native Americans consider the heart to be the center of being. If we are to spiritually evolve, we need to give more credence to the whole body experience, to a consciousness that includes more than rationality and thought, a consciousness that is more heart than mind. Mary calls us to live out the calling of the soul. It's not my brain magnifies the Lord. It's not even my heart magnifies the Lord. It is my soul that magnifies the Lord. This is a deeper, richer, fuller experience of the life than what we have been taught. We love God with all our strength, all our mind, all our heart. The light of God, which Jesus brought to us Gentiles, enlightens us. It can liberate us from the darkness that can encompass our souls, the darkness that is induced by the headlines, by the sense that when we are fighting for justice, sometimes it feels like we are just punching a mountain of jello. We wait for the light of God to come to us so that we can magnify it in our world. God restoreth our soul. Let us then mark this point in time when the darkness is very dark, the daylight is very short, the night seems like it could go on forever. We need to remember the light is coming. We await it. And when it arrives, we will magnify it. Let us pray. Dear God, our Creator, you have given us the teachings of the Jewish people who have suffered much over thousands of years. We live in a world where an old building is 40 years old. Help us to stop, to slow down enough to hear what is given to us, to hear the sounds of our own souls yearning for the peace of God, and to look forward to the arrival of the light, Jesus the Christ. All this we ask in your name. Amen.